And I want to put kind of two models of leadership in front of you, not because either of them is perfect. I don't think there is any perfect definition of leadership, but really just to help provoke your thinking about your own institutions. So one of the things that's come out of the understanding of willful blindness is that heroic leadership, this kind of one heroic soloist at the top, is incredibly dangerous because, as you've just heard from Chris and Nick, the world is too complicated for one genius, however brilliant, to be able to hold it all in their heads. So we're all moving to teamwork, and this isn't because we want to pay six people to do the job of one. It's because there's a recognition that collective intelligence is more powerful and is more creative than solo intelligence, no matter how smart you are. But there's a real, I think, fuzziness around actually what teamwork is and how it works. So there's some very good research that's been done at MIT by Tom Malone at the Center for Collective Intelligence, which I think gives this a really interesting perspective. He brought in hundreds of people, he tested their IQ, he gave them hard problems to solve, and he could show, as we all knew, as he knew really, there's a rough correlation between IQ and problem solving. It is not a perfect correlation, it's a rough correlation. Then he puts all of these people into teams, and he gives them very high order design problems to solve. And he discovers what probably all of you have discovered in your life, which is some teams are fantastic and they just fire off ideas. And others spend the whole time trying to understand what the question was. And so he gathers up the results and you can see that there are a couple of really amazing teams. So the onus of the experiment is, what are the characteristics of these amazing teams? Well, what's interesting, first of all, is what isn't. So the best teams are not the teams with the highest aggregate IQ. So this idea that we've had, and that a lot of organizations still have, which is all you really need to do is hire the brightest guys, and it is usually guys, the brightest guys you can find, and you're sorted, not proven. In addition, the most productive, creative, problem-solving teams are not the teams with one or two IQ superstars. So again, the idea you get one person and he kind of raises the level of everybody else, not true. Only three characteristics define the really successful teams. The first is that they tend to score very highly on a test called reading the mind and the eye test. What that is loosely a test for empathy. It's about how connected am I with you? And to some degree, I think it may be a surrogate marker for imagination. The second is when they replayed the problem-solving sessions, they discovered that the best teams spent roughly the same amount of time hearing each other. So everybody made an equal contribution, no passengers, no dominant voices. Everybody counts. And the third characteristic of the high-achieving teams is that they had more women in them. Now, the researchers themselves don't know what that means. Is it an element of diversity, different life experience, or is it simply that women typically score more highly on reading the mind in the eye test, so you're doubling down on the empathy quotient? But the thing I think that matters most in this is that what it shows is that in great teamwork, what matters isn't who the members are, it's what's happening between them. And indeed, the researchers make this kind of offhand, provocative comment, which is actually, it may matter more than anything about who's in the team. The way I think about this is, it's actually the mortar, not the bricks, that may create the strongest organization, the bonds between people. You could call it social capital too. The habits of generosity, reciprocity, and trust built over time that makes people feel safe to speak up, ask questions, and challenge because they know and they trust each other.